This is a Neanderthal skull, and this is a human skull. According to the latest research, Neanderthals most likely had larger brains than us. However, as is the case with most things in life, size can only really get you so far. Longtime viewers of the channel will recall hearing me rant about Notch 2NL. Why do I choose to rant about it so much? Well, it's a mystery, as old as time itself. But the truth is that my obsession with Notch 2NL may have something to do with the fact that we owe so much of what makes us human to just this one gene. So here's the rundown. Around 600,000 years ago, a series of gene duplications in our DNA created three extra copies of Notch 2NL. Now, this was a fundamentally important event in our evolution, as Notch 2NL stimulates neuronal stem cells to divide into nerve cells. In short, having more copies of Notch 2NL means you get more neurons. As a result, our brains grew in size a lot and very fast, as you can see over here. I would even go as far as to say that it was these duplications that end up separating these happy monkeys from these depressed monkeys over here. However, the Notch 2NL gene duplication doesn't explain the difference in cognition between us poor bastards and our Neanderthal cousins. This is the story of why you and I ended up being a part of a group that would become the only surviving hominid species. I've never been a fan of lotteries. I don't like stupid things, and I think lotteries are fucking stupid. That said, I must admit that the sheer stupidity of lotteries does help contextualize some things, like the odds of something so extraordinarily rare happening. All this is to say that your odds of winning the next Mega Millions draw is around 1 in 176 million. You're 11,000 times more likely to be hit by lightning than you are to win the draw. The reason I'm telling you all of this is because your DNA is made out of 3 billion nucleotide pairs, which means that the odds of one specific nucleotide in that 3 billion long sequence getting replaced by another nucleotide and causing a single amino acid change in a single protein in your entire body is a ridiculous 1 in 3 billion. And yet, despite the seemingly insurmountable odds, our ancestors, those lucky early Homo sapiens, they managed to hit the jackpot. So sometime in our evolutionary history, an adenine nucleotide mutated into guanine, changing the triplet code AAG to AGG. And because AAG and AGG code for different amino acids, this tiny change introduced a single amino acid substitution in the TKTL1 protein, a protein that is made out of 596 amino acids. A protein that, until then, was exactly the same in both Homo sapiens and Neanderthals. Now, however, it was different. The 317th amino acid had been replaced. Lysine was swapped out for arginine. All other 595 amino acids remained the same. What separated Neanderthal and human TKTL1 was a difference of a single amino acid, and from here on onwards, I'll refer to human HTKTL1 as HTKTL1 and Neanderthal TKTL1 as ATKTL1. A for ancestral or archaic, since this is what we started out with. So a team of scientists devised an experiment where they inserted HTKTL1 and ATKTL1 into developing brain tissue belonging to a mouse. And here are the results that they obtained. This graph shows the number of mitotic basal progenitor cells, which are the cells that replicate and divide to give you the 86 billion brain cells that live inside your head right now. You can see from this graph how HTKTL1 gives you a small edge over the Neanderthals' ATKTL1, but it's like hardly anything to write home about, is it? Well, hold on a minute, because there are actually two types of basal progenitor cells. You have the basal intermediate progenitor cells, and you've got your basal radial glia. If you separate the data to uncover the effects of H and ATKTL1 on the two types of cells, here's what you get. HTKTL1, with its single amino acid change, is like catnip for the basal radial glia. It's pure fireworks. Now, here's the thing. If your neuronal progenitor cells were pop stars for whatever reason, your basal radial glia would be Taylor Swift. Just like Taylor Swift is constantly putting out a lot of new music all the time, your basal radio glia produce a ton of neurons, way more than anything that the basal intermediate progenitor cells could ever possibly dream of producing. The difference becomes really apparent when you compare the developing mouse and human brain. The first thing that you'll notice is just how many more neurons the human brain tissue boasts. Otherwise, however, the two brain tissues are eerily similar. They've got roughly the same number of apical radioglia and basal intermediate cells. The difference? It's the basal radioglia. It's so much more. Courtesy of TKTL1. And what the amino acid change that gave rise to HTKTL1 did was turbocharge the basal radioglia. More basal radioglia, more neurons. More smart. When a mutation that's so advantageous appears, it quickly spreads throughout a population to become the dominant form, and HTKTL1 is one of the most successful mutations out there. The frequency of HTKTL1 in humans alive today is 0.9997, meaning that out of the 8 billion humans alive today, only 2.4 million are estimated to carry the ancestral HTKTL1. And about 100,000 of those are located in this area right here. The Khoisan people are an indigenous ethnic group located in southern Africa. 1 in 3 members of this group have the ancestral form of TKTL1 that was seen in Neanderthals. Now, this is interesting because the Khoisan people are believed to be one of the first, if not the earliest humans, to split apart from other humans. More than 150,000 years ago. The fact that ancestral TKTL1 remains common in Khoisan is a good indicator that this mutation that gave rise to HTKTL1 occurred in Africa very early on in our shared evolutionary history, but either during or just after the Khoisan population split from the main human population. Recent evidence from a preprint study on a UK population suggests that people with ATKTL1 are substantially less likely to hold a college or university degree and are much more likely to have not completed any formal education. Now, I think I have to say this, that, you know, it's important to remember that throughout most of our history, our portrayal of Neanderthals left much to be desired. Far from being unintelligent and primitive hominins, Neanderthals actually often demonstrated advanced technological skills, making tools that often matched those made by the ancient Homo sapiens that they lived alongside. A recent discovery by scientists at NYU revealed that Neanderthals even created stone tools that were held together by a multi-component adhesive. Yes, I suppose Neanderthals had glue, made out of a mixture of liquid bitumen with the addition of 55% ochre. If you'd like to learn more about Neanderthals and why they went extinct, check the description below for a link to a Substack blog that I wrote. It's 100% free to read. In the description, you should also find an insanely long list of citations because, well, citations are important. Don't trust anything you read or see online unless it's properly cited. Finally, I really don't think this video will do well. It's a weird topic, but I love weird topics, and I love this topic particularly. I guess I am weird. So if you're one of the dozen people still watching, thank you for sticking around and giving me some of your valuable time. My name is Hashim, and this is my YouTube channel. Hope to see you all next time.